following interview was conducted with Professor Lawrence D. Cargnino for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Thursday, September 13th, 2007, at his residence in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about where you were born in your early life and family.
Okay. Well, I was born near Springfield, Illinois. And my father came from Italy. My mother also came from Italy in the early 1900s. And my father worked in the coal mines for 35 years. So I spent my early years in the coal mining camps. And went through high school at Girard, Illinois, near Springfield. And following that, I stayed out from high school to college about 5.5 or 6 years. Finally decided I should go to college, so I went to Illinois State, pursued a BS degree there, and left there in 1941. Then went to work for some of the military programs. That was near World War II. And then from there I went to work for the Ford School at Willow Run, Michigan. And I worked there for 3.5 years, I expect. And following that I went to Boeing in Seattle. Worked there for nearly a year. And then I interviewed for this job at Purdue in probably August of 1945. And Purdue had advertised in Flying Magazine that they were beginning a program called Air Transportation. This was to be a part of the School of Aeronautical Engineering, which was just being formed at that time in July 1, 1945. The school was formed. Before that, it had been an option in mechanical engineering. And this was the first part of the school, the first time, that fall of 1945. I interviewed for the job. Dean Potter was acting president at the time. Elmer Bruin was head of the department, and I interviewed for the job for air transportation, this new program, and was hired on that day. Went over and interviewed Dean Potter, which was a part of the program then, and so I started working that fall. There were a group of about 12 of us who were with the school. This was air transportation and aeronautical engineering both, about 12 of us. I was maybe nearly the youngest, but I don't think I was nearly the youngest. I was 32 at the time. And today I'm the only one left of that group, which makes me kind of fearful. At any rate,
Can I interrupt one moment? Could you what sort of programs when you worked for Willow Run and Boeing before you came here? Could you tell the researchers a little bit what sort of the nature and kinds of things you were doing?
Yes. Uh-huh. Well, the schools were primarily for the benefit of the employees. So we had large numbers who would come through the school wanting to know different phases of it. We went all the way up through the pilots, test pilots for the airplanes, who would come in and present problems that they were having and have us advise them in a theoretical sense what might be the problem with the airplane or so on. And the Ford Aircraft School was at Willow Run near Ann Arbor, Michigan. And this was a B-24 program. Made large numbers of B-24s. The Boeing program was with the B-29 program, the big fortress, and that was about the same sort of assignment.
Were you teaching, is that right?
I was teaching at the time, yes. Mm-hmm. And when I came to interview at Purdue, Dr. Gruen felt like this was that I would make a perfect fit for the program. And I was offered a job the same day, starting out as a full-time instructor at the rate of $2,500 for 10 months. Well, anyway, I enjoyed the program. The thing was, it kind of floored me a little because after I came here, I learned that there were no courses. These courses at air transportation had not been taught before. We just had a sketchy outline in the bulletin about what the course was supposed to cover. We had to develop our own curriculum, essentially. No textbooks. We had to use notes or else select textbooks from part of the program. There were no labs, and yet this program required extensive labs.
Where were you located?
The airport. Most of the courses were located at the airport. In fact, all of them, because there were already some labs there for aeronautics and engineering when it was a part of mechanical. And so we had to develop the labs along with the courses. And this took a bit of effort.
I bet.
At the same time, I started working off a master's degree. And we were allowed to take two courses during a semester or one during the summer towards an advanced degree. Well, right from the beginning, I was a little bit apprehensive about the program because it was a non-engineering degree program, yet it was offered in a school that was engineering. Aeronautical engineering degree was well planned and already in operation because it had been taught in mechanical as different courses. And yet this was a non-engineering. But Dr. Bruin felt like this was good because it encased all the program, not just the design and the building of the airplane, but then the use of it, the proper use of it in the form of the airlines and the large numbers of people would be needed for the airlines, for the scheduling and the operation and maintenance and so forth for the airplanes. So it seems like the whole program did fit together well. But it was the only program in the country, I think, that combined the engineering and the non-engineering. And anyway, it was successful in terms of it attracted large numbers of people. We had probably four or five times the number we could accept in the freshman year. Most of the returning veterans were people who wanted this program because it linked them with the programs they had in the military. And so my first classes were full of returning veterans, some as high as colonels, lieutenant colonels, majors, captains. And there was a tremendous range of people there, and then there were some who were maybe just out of high school.
Your typical freshman.
Yeah, but it really kept us on our toes, I tell you, at the time. The program was beginning with the sophomore year, because the freshman year was common to engineering, and all the students took the same program as engineering students took. So it was a strong program from that point of view, strong in a freshman program. And then we got them a sophomore. And in addition to the large numbers that were attracted, they did well in placement because there again, there was a large need for people with that kind of background. The airlines were expanding, and small aircraft people were developing their program. them did well, and...
What sort of jobs would the people take when they finished? They work for the airlines, primarily?
Well, not completely, but this also included the flight. It was the flight program that Purdue already had by itself. And then it included the maintenance, and then all of the airlines, people that the airlines hired in a number of different categories. So the airlines hired some of these, but the majority of them went to work for aerospace companies in programs that which they worked with the engineer, but maybe didn't do the same kind of work the engineers did, but they were sort of assistants to the engineers. And that's where they went, and the placement was satisfactory. And the program continued for probably 10, 12 years. It started in 45, and I think it finally ended about 1958, so that would make it like 13 years. And the reason that the program was eventually canceled was that they got a new head in here, a man from California, who had a very theoretical background, PhD from Caltech, and he came in and immediately he said, I can understand the aeronautical engineering program. I think it's a strong program. I don't understand the air transportation program. To me, it's probably a very good program, but I don't see it connected with aeronautical engineering. It's too big a departure between the two groups. So immediately he said, we talked to him and said, well, just a minute, you're coming in here new, you don't understand the whole thing, give it time. He says, I'm willing to give it some time, but I think that it needs to go into another area, and I don't think it belongs in the engineering area, especially since it's a non-engineering degree. So we kind of kicked that around for a couple of years, although it was obvious that he just was not satisfied with it. And he eventually left. He only stayed here about 3 years, and his name was Clouser, Milton Clouser. And meanwhile, Elmer Bruin has stepped down as head, just teaching in the program. So what eventually happened then, we picked up a new head, a fellow named Hal DeGroff, who had first come in as a temporary head because Dr. Clouser took a year's leave of absence. And even Hal DeGroff wondered about the program. He had been here a year or two earlier, and he kind of felt the same way that Clouser did, that it was, the air transportation program was a good program, but probably belonged in another area. So they got the dean involved in this. But this time, Dean Potter had moved on, and we had a new dean. The dean kind of felt the same way. He thought that it was the only program that was non-engineering, that was in the engineering program. Mechanical, electrical, all the others were just straight engineering programs that did not have a separate program like this. And eventually, what happened was that the thinking was maybe this ought to be a new program in the technology area. And in the meantime, technology had gotten kind of a start at Purdue, and they had some programs going. mostly two-year programs. And so they undertook this program as a two-year program and got it underway, and then it seemed to make sense to everyone that maybe this was a school that wanted the program and they would develop it. And so this kind of moved in that direction. And today it's in that area, not the same as it was originally in air transportation, but it is a four-year program. And they have given the ability to go into a master's program. And it's done very well. The program has done very well. So.
Is it within aviation technology? Is that where its home is? Okay. Did you have undergraduates and graduates in the program as well? Or was it primarily just...
The air transportation program never had more than just a bachelor's.
Okay.
Yeah. And there were about three or four of us who were hired in as air transportation people, and the others were aeronautical engineering people in that initial group, about a dozen. And some of us, I think, I may have been the only one who, from the very beginning, the first year I was here, that summer, I taught some engineering courses, mostly propulsion, power plant, and which was a required course in aeronautical engineering for those who took that option. And so what happened was I continued to teach those courses in engineering as well as air transportation. And when the transportation program pulled it up, I just moved 100% into aeronautical engineering. It didn't bother me that much. Some of the others left because they really had a hard time continuing.
Call of 12 that you talked about that were in it.
Yeah. One person who, well, he wasn't here in the original group, but he was here after the first year. He moved into freshman engineering and worked there for 4 or 5 years. And then he retired early because he had a heart condition. And he eventually died before he was 70. So that's kind of a nutshell.
What was the campus like during the World War II, in contrast?
It would be hard for me to describe it. We came here, and we were told...
Had you not been to the Midwest before you came for an interview, or had you? Well, Illinois, perhaps, yeah.
Well, I was raised... Frances was raised in Michigan. I met her when I was at Willow Run. But housing was just non-existent. We came here and we stayed in a room. We just found a room.
In a house?
In a house. Shared a bath. And then Francis would get up early and get the newspaper as soon as it came out. And then she would call or interview or go see the places. And we moved from a one room, and we were in that one room place there for maybe 3 or 4 weeks, I guess. And then we found one, a kind of an apartment, an upstairs apartment, which had two or three rooms. Again, you had to share a bath. And...
could you cook there in the apartment or not?
Yeah, we cooked in the apartment. They had a stove, kind of a small oil stove. But the students, they found it even more difficult. And some of my students, I remember, were told that they would be admitted, but they had to have an address. And they couldn't find any place to live, so they were living in the cars. And they would go to a place that had student rooms, and they'd say, can I park my car out here and stay in the car and use your address so I can enroll, and maybe I'll find a place to live.
Wow.
Or you'll have a place or something. And that's what happened. It was unreal. Finally, we moved from an upstairs apartment to a downstairs, which we had our own bath.
Uh-huh.
This was on North 6th Street, near where the YMCA is now, and the YWCA. And housing was just non-existent.
What was going on in the village? Was there anything in what was Chauncey Village like? Did they have any stores and things there? In the village, you know, Chauncey Village, were there stores?
Oh, yes, there were stores there because the university had been in existence for a number
sure.
of years.
Okay.
And, but what we finally did, they moved about 1947. They moved a bunch of Quonset huts, like the ones that were sitting on the campus where the aeronautical building is now. And they moved them along the Airport Road. They didn't have any of the student apartments then yet. And these Quonset huts were divided into three or four units. And we had one of those units. There were three different families in this one closet. The walls were so thin you could hear conversations all the way down. Kids crying.
Good reminiscence, right? Did you have a family as well? Did you have children?
Well, we didn't have any children when we came. We had a Francis pregnant. So we had a girl, daughter in May of 1946. Now we came in August of 45. Huh? So, mm-hmm. So she was born over St. Elizabeth Hospital. And this is when they had the upstairs apartment.
It's probably a walk up too, right? Were the students that came back that were in your class, the older ones, what were they really eager to?
Very eager.
Do you notice a difference between those, say, and the undergrads that you had at that time?
Yeah, they had a purpose. I mean, they were so eager. They were so eager, and this was in the, what was that program they had where the government paid for the Bill of Rights?
The GI Bill?
The GI Bill of Rights. And they weren't paid very much, but there'd be enough so they could subsist. But they were so diligent and so anxious. And whatever you assigned, boy, you didn't have to worry about them not turning it on time. And I know some of the students who came out of high school, they were flabbergasted. They'd come to me and say, gee whiz, I can't keep up with the assignments here. I know they're eager, and they've got experience and so on, but it's hard for me.
I bet, right. That's quite an age difference, and they had a lot of experience, you know, they've been in the service. Yeah. A couple things that you were sort of involved in, and incidentally, I should say, that book that you co-authored, that's a very good book. I've not read it cover to cover, but we have a copy in the library, yes, and I've used it as a resource. It's very good. Your picture's quite good, too, there. There's a picture in the early years when you first came here.
Oh, you're talking about
the 50th anniversary, yes.
50th anniversary.
That one, that particular one. I know there's another one you wrote, but that's the one with Grant and Gustus. Yeah.
Right.
And I've been there.
Well, in my early years, I started writing a book. First the two or three courses that I taught, I had to develop extensive notes, copious notes. And then somebody said one day when, instead of all these notes, why don't you put it in book form? So I talked to a couple of publishers and finally got an arrangement where I didn't have to wait a long time. co-authorship with another. But I was the main author, and he was what they call the, I got 10% for the royalty, and he got 5 because he only did it like 2 or 3 chapters. But anyway, that sold over 70,000 copies. Gosh, later he had even, but the thing is, it never got very expensive. Today's books were $90 and $100, but that book was like $12, $14. It originally came out in 1950. And, meanwhile, I was working towards a master's, too, at the same time.
At the same time, wow.
And that kept me so busy, I don't know how I ever survived that. I took about 4 or 5 hours of sleep.
It's amazing what you can do sometimes. How about that war surplus? One of the things in that book that kind of caught my eye was that Curtis Wright C-46 plane that you were able to get, and also the
P-59. There's some wild stories about that. Well, the military was giving away a lot of war surplus material, some of it nearly brand new. And we had a fellow on campus by the name of Lasco. I don't know.
I've heard his name, yes.
And he was, the dean kind of appointed him, Dean Potter, to go to these places and get as much equipment as he could. And he did a tremendous job, especially with the industrial engineering, the laboratory where they had all these extensive machines, automatic machines were just coming in to play then. And he got just tremendous amount of equipment that way, just for free, by just going out and getting it. And O.D. Lasco is a tremendous person. And mostly through him and through, well, just the military making contact with the school. And we were able to get this C-46 with the idea that it would not be flown. Fly it in here, but that would be it. The P-59 was the same way. This was one of the original jets, P-59. And they flew it in here. Howard Pemberton with Allison in Indianapolis flew it in here and made 2 or 3 passes at the airport. And got everybody excited. All the town people rushed out when they heard all this.
Sure.
And, but it was not to be small. We used it for teaching primarily in the air transportation program because this was an operational type program. It did not have much to do with anything to do with design and development. And but I'll tell you a story about that. We mentioned that in the history I mentioned. We hadn't run the airplane, but we knew we could run it on the ground. Try to fly it. And one day we had been reading about all the things, about what to do to start it and so on. We knew quite a bit about it from our teaching. And we drew straws, about 4 or 5 of us in the air transportation group, as to who would go out and start it. Well, I got the short straw, or the long straw, whatever. Anyway, I got the chance to go out and start it. And the airplane was sitting on the south side of the building, about 20 feet from the building, I'd say 30 feet. And the other 4 fellows were all up in front of the building waiting for me to
turn them.
I had all the instructions in there about turn the switch on, turn that on, and turn this on. And I went through all that and then tried to start it, and it didn't start. Well, fortunately, we had a fellow up there with them had a fire extinguisher, and but anyway, finally, after 3 or 4 attempts, I got it started, and then I looked up, happy, and I see these fellows all going, cut it, meaning stop the engine, so I kind of half turned around, and I just see the heat waves from the heat coming out of the airplane in the back, and there were some airplanes light planes behind us, and they were just dancing from that heat wave, and we quickly shut it off. What had happened was every time I would try to start it, it didn't start, I was emptying fuel in the engine. And so when it did finally catch, this fuel, there was an excess amount of fuel there, and the flame extended all the way through the engine part and out through the tail and out of the airplane. And I guess there was a flame sticking out of the back of the airplane about 6 or 8 feet long. And of course the fellow with the fire extinguisher rushed out, but there wasn't much he could do. Fortunately, we didn't set any of those light planes on fire. They were far enough back on the
line. Were you finally able to get extinguished though, the fire?
Well, the best it burned itself out.
Oh, okay.
You couldn't really extinguish it because the fire was coming from inside the engine.
Okay.
Through the big exhaust pipe.
Bill, you served under quite a few heads and also some presidents. Dr. Hubdy was president when you came, right?
Dr. Hubdy came in January of 1946.
Okay.
And I recall meeting him at one of the engineering faculty meetings. He had just joined the university and he elected to attend this meeting, which was an evening meeting. And this was 1946, and he was such a young looking man at the time, dark hair, you know.
He made some change. He made quite a few changes. He was here for a long time.
25 years. My impression of a really fine president.
And you had some different heads over time then.
Yeah, I went from Hubby to Hanson, I guess.
Right.
And then from Hanson to Beery. And then Jishke, now Cordova.
Mm-hmm. Right. The school now is, they added on, how did aeronautics get added on to the title of School of Aeronautical when they made some?
Well, I'll tell you about it. First, when I came here, the school was called Aeronautical Engineering. It didn't list air transportation except in the description internal. It talked about one of the options. And it was like that until about 1959 or 60, 1960. In 1960, and we had moved to the airport.
Excuse me, had you been on campus at one time?
Well, the office was on campus, and there were a couple of classes on campus, but the labs were all at the airport. And in 1949, we elected to move the whole thing to the airport. And so that all the classes that we taught and the labs, and we arranged it so that the classes would be mostly in the morning along with the labs, and the afternoons were free for the students to take courses on campus. And there was a bus connection between the campus and the airport, free bus. And that's the way it was working until about 1960. Meanwhile, I say our whole operation was on the airport. It was like a separate school, ideally. And I never spent much time on campus, except for evening meetings, like that. But then in 1960, there was a program on campus called Engineering Science. Really engineering mechanics, I mean, at that time. That was a program that was primarily advanced courses in math, physics, and the sciences, but not much engineering. And it was a program that was designed for the student to move from that to an advanced program. Some of the engineering schools, or maybe math, or even physics. And they had a head who resigned in 1959 or 1960, probably 59, resigned and took a job as dean at the University of Buffalo. And they started to try to find a head, and were not able really to, they had interviewed a few people and didn't think it was, they were right. So they wondered about what to do with that program. Well, the dean talked to Dr. DeGroff, who's head of aeronautical, and asked him if it were possible to combine the two programs, since at about that time all the engineering schools were, beginning in 58, were putting more math and more physics in all their courses, and they thought maybe this would be a good way to go and we could have both programs, he could interview and handle both programs. Some of us wondered about it because while there were some similarities, the faculties were so much different between the two schools. In aeronautical, the program was geared towards a vehicle. Everybody could understand that, whether it's an airplane or missile or something else. In engineering science, they had no vehicle. It was just a kind of a broad base math science program. At any rate, we combined the two programs, and we moved from the airport to the campus. And that was about the time that the aviation technology program was being developed. So they turned all that building and the facilities out there to engineering, to aviation technology. And we moved to the campus in that little building that is just north of Grissom, which is called, I guess, nuclear engineering now. It was a small building, just a lot of offices, and each one of us doubled up, two of us. And I shared an office with Professor Bruin, who had been the head who hired me. And we had a kind of a tight squeeze in there for a while. But anyway, that program had difficulty getting together. My job was, I was chairman of the committee at the time, of the curriculum committee. And Dr. DeGroff said, Larry, get these people together and come up with a program that is similar through the, at least the first 2 or 3 years. After that, they can vary quite a bit. Well, there was so much dissension in that program in engineering science to begin with that I found they weren't getting along, and they had all kinds of strange ideas about which direction they should go. And when I would call a committee meeting, I had difficulty getting them all to attend. The one group that felt a certain way about it said, well, if the other group's going to meet, I don't want to attend. So I didn't know what to do, but it was obvious then to me that this could not continue. There was just too much difference. When we would have faculty meetings of the school, which was now Aeronautical and Engineering Science, that was the title, no longer just Aeronautical Engineering, Aeronautical and Engineering Science. But when the faculty came in for the meeting, all the aeronautical would sit on this side of the room, engineering and science people sit on that side of the room. Whenever the head would propose something and ask for a vote, one group would say yes, the other group would say no. That just could not continue. To me, I just thought, oh, this was not good at all. I was kind of unhappy that I had stayed by that time. I wondered about the program. This is when they had, just 2 years after they had canceled the air transportation program, and I was in aeronautical engineering, and it made me wonder about what eventually would happen here. But anyway, we survived for nearly 10 years, I think. And by 1969 and 1970, the dean of engineering decided that maybe it was no longer useful to have an engineering science program. And he got a lot of argument against it from the engineering science people. But I guess he had the backing of Dr. Hovde and the trustees. And so the engineering science program was canceled. And the school was, of course, by that time getting into a lot of astronautical work. And we were starting to teach programs in mostly astronautics and just for certain groups. And so that program was canceled and the faculty were assigned in different schools. And one or two of them went to industrial engineering. I'm trying to think of the name of
would that be Arnie Sweet?
Sweet. Arnie Sweet was one of them.
Okay.
Yeah, he was engineering science. And some left the university. Bogdanov, I don't know if you knew Jack Bogdanov. But several went to mechanical engineering. But anyway, that's when the school became School of Aeronautics and Astronautics, or in full terms, Aeronautical and Astronautical Engineering, the present title of it. And so that's
how it was.
That's how that
happened. Since you've been retired, what sort of have you been involved at all at the school?
For quite a while. Well, when I retired in 1979, I've been retired it'll be 29 years now, so in the spring. You had to retire at a certain age. And
was
I had,
it 65 at that time? Or?
Well, yeah, depended on your age and when you hired in. I was 32 when I came here and was told that my retirement would be when I reached the age of 66. But my birthday is in December, so I stayed until I was 66, which meant 79, I had to retire. And Dr. Hanson was president then. And I went through a retirement. And prior to that time, you had to leave. I mean, you couldn't go back and you couldn't continue. But beginning in 79, the university said, if the department wants you to come back, you can come back half-time for 5 years, no longer than 5 years. So I talked to the head of the department, and I really wasn't ready to retire. So I mean, I was so active and so involved, and I thought, now here all I'm going to do is cut grass, run a lawn power mower, and maintain the house, and that's, in other words, you switch from being very busy to just
doing fiddly stuff, yeah.
Yeah. So I went back to halftime until 1984, and then I had to leave. Now you can stay longer.
Did you do teaching during that time as well?
Yeah, no, by that time I think I was just doing mostly administrative work. I had started a co-op program in the school in about 19, developed that program, and that got to the point where when I retired, we had about 125 students in co-op, when our total enrollment would be about 450 undergrads. And that was a good mix, because that means that about roughly a fourth of the students were involved in co-op, where they alternated with industry and then with school. And you could tell those students, I could tell in class which ones had been out of co-op, because they were ahead of their classmates. It just makes a difference, because you're out there dealing with the hardware and what the problems are in the field. That just made all the difference. They understood the problem. So I was mainly doing that, and I was doing all of the counseling, the thing that Jim Barony did for quite a long time, still does, I guess. And I was 450 students, that was a, and I was scheduling all the classes, and with the assistance of the head, assigning faculty to teach certain courses and kind of rotating that, and then handling the teaching assistants, the graduate students.
That's quite
so you might say it's mostly, by that time I was doing mostly administrative work.
How about a, got one of an outstanding event in your life? Think of one?
Now that's fire in that, because you know.
Well, that's okay. I've got one other one. How about the longest memory? You could put that in there too, right? You might have another one though.
When I first came here, they didn't have anybody. They had a writer club, and somehow.